My name's Andrew Hopkins, and today I'm excited to talk to you about AWS-LC and our journey for FIPS certification, how we're using it inside AWS, and how you can get started using yourself today. So first, what's the requirement? Why are we here? We're here because many of you probably operate in some kind of regulated environment. Maybe you're dealing with financial services, dealing with government contracts, or like web PKI, where you work in an industry that kind of has additional regulations on how you operate. And specifically for cryptography, one of the most common ones is the FIPS-140-3 certification. This is a process outlined by NIST, which specifies which algorithms you can use for cryptography and sets the standards for the testing and implementation of those algorithms. So for you to run your workloads on AWS, you need some help from AWS to meet those requirements. And in this case, you need parts of AWS to use FIPS certified cryptography in our platform so you can run your workloads on top of us. So the first case where you might be familiar with this is with our FIPS endpoints. So in like such as the US Gov West 1 region, we have our FIPS endpoints for all of the services you're familiar with. The FIPS endpoints provide access to the same APIs that you're familiar with calling in other regions, but for in the FIPS endpoints, they're using FIPS-approved algorithms and an implementation. So when you connect to these endpoints, AWS makes sure you negotiate only an approved cipher suite and that on the AWS side, we use an approved implementation. It's still up to you to configure your clients to connect to the correct endpoint and on your side to use an approved implementation for your connection. But this isn't the only place where FIPS is relevant. If we dive a little bit deeper, here we have a theoretical large object storage system and how you might design it in US Gov West 1. So the first case where we have FIPS requirements will be in our API gateway, where when you connect over the internet, you still need that FIPS implementations. But this is an object storage system, so we're going to want to persist that data somewhere. And maybe in this case, we're persisting it on EBS volumes. But you need to encrypt that data before you write it to those hard drives, and that encryption needs to be using an approved algorithm, and in this case, something like AES-XTS, and an approved implementation. But it's not necessarily just in disk encryption. You might be running part of your workloads on AWS Lambda, and in your runtime code, you still are maybe dealing with signing or verifying customer data, and that also needs to use approved algorithms. And specifically in Lambda, that's an interesting use case because you have a variety of choices of your Lambda runtime execution, and you can be writing this in a variety of programming languages and can be running on a variety of host types. Finally, we might not need FIPS everywhere. In this case, maybe there's some kind of billing service that's dealing with just metadata about who to bill and how much to bill them, and that might not need FIPS. But you want the option of saying maybe you want to simplify your deployments and just use FIPS cryptography everywhere. So we want to make sure your use case fits with any variety of places you might need it. So how do we go about getting FIPS everywhere? The approach AWS is taking is by centralizing this in AWS libcrypto or AWS-LC. So this is a C cryptographic library that hosts all of the common implementations for algorithms for a variety of use cases. And this includes maybe the TLS use case for key exchanges and symmetric encryption, your disk encryption with AES-XTS, and signing and verifying for your certificates. By centralizing our implementations in one library, we get the benefits of write once and use multiple places, and maybe if we're improving the performance for a particular use case, there are other customers that can use that in their services, or you can use it yourself. And specifically also for FIPS, this helps us simplify our FIPS strategy by only going through this process once, verifying AWS-LC is correct, and then using that in all the possible places we might need that FIPS cryptographic module. But you're probably thinking, you're not probably writing C libraries or C applications in 2023. You're working in some other languages that are a higher level abstraction. So how do we get AWS-LC to be easily usable in those other use cases? So going back to the first use case for TLS, we looked at our signal-to-noise family of libraries. These libraries provide a TLS implementation and a quick implementation for the respective protocols. S2N TLS is a C library and was able to easily migrate to AWS-LC FIPS. So on our server side, we're using S2N TLS with AWS-LC FIPS and getting the approved algorithms from AWS-LC and the protocol implementation from S2N TLS. But you can also use this on your client side. So if you use a new SDK built on top of the AWS Common Runtime, one example of this is the Java SDK version 2, you can also use S2N TLS with AWS-LC on your client side. S2N Quick is similar to this in that it provides a quick implementation, but it's written in Rust. And that gave us an interesting opportunity where Rust has a foreign function interface where they can call a native C library directly, but we wanted to give our Rust developers a more idiomatic and familiar Rust feeling experience, which is why we released AWS-LC Lib, or AWS LibCrypto for Rust, also known as AWS-LCRS. So this is a Rust library written in a familiar higher level Rust language that provides the same Rust crypto API that you might already be using, and under the hood is using AWS-LC for all of the implementations. And this is useful because this gets an easy access for Rust applications and libraries to use a FIPS certified module. And while Rust is great and AWS is increasing our adoption of Rust, we've historically been a Java service shop. So a lot of our customers are internally using Java to write their services, and we wanted to give them the same benefits, which is why we launched the Amazon Credo crypto provider. So ACCP provides the same familiar Java high-level abstraction, and under the hood is using AWS-LC for all of its implementations. So you get the benefits of fast, high-performance C implementation and the benefits of FIPS compliance with the easy-to-use Java interfaces. And this is one of my first call to actions for you, is if you are working in C, Java, or Rust, take a look at these libraries and see if they're applicable to your use case. We think they're easy to drop into existing applications and libraries, and you can easily get a free performance win without having to rewrite or change your interaction with a lot of the crypto layer in your code. And with these two libraries and the S2N family, we think we have a good start of getting AWS-LC FIPS everywhere, but there's one more key point to getting FIPS everywhere, and that's talking about our operating environments. So when you validate a library for FIPS cryptographic module, you validate it on a particular operating environment, which is a combination of CPU and operating system. This is because AWS-LC has platform-dependent assembly code for those optimizations that need to be tested and certified independently for each platform that we want to run on by NIST. And similarly, for the operating systems, AWS relies on some syscalls that are dependent on different operating systems, so the combination of those have to be tested for FIPS. Initially, we were looking at AWS use cases, which is why we targeted Graviton for ARM and x86 for EC2, and looking at Amazon Linux. But we also knew, such as AWS Wicker, which provides client software for secure messaging, we knew there was a use case for extending where AWS-LC FIPS could be used, which is why we added more end-user devices, such as Android, iOS, and Windows. So by verifying AWS-LC FIPS on these variety of operating systems and CPU platforms, we now think we have a good solution to use AWS-LC FIPS everywhere. And with the previous libraries I mentioned, we have an easy-to-use higher-level abstraction to migrate service teams and you to those modules. The final part of this is making sure the FIPS solution is not any negatively impacting performance or capacity for AWS and for you, our customers. So the question is, can FIPS be fast? And the good news is yes, FIPS can be fast. So here I'm showing the AES 128-bit with Galois counter mode throughput on a C7G instance. This is the latest Graviton 3 instance, and you can see as the message size increases, our performance increases up to around 3,000 megabytes per second. And you'll also note that this is the 2021 release of AWS-LC. So NIST is interested in verifying a snapshot in time, so we periodically release a FIPS version of AWS-LC and submit that for validation. And when we first launched, this is where our baseline performance was. Over the course of the year, we looked at ways to improve that performance, specifically for AES, looking at loop unrolling and performing more AES operations in parallel. So in 2022, we released a further optimized implementation that was able to achieve 4,000 megabytes per second of throughput. And finally, in the end of 2022, we all know that Graviton 3 became generally available, and Graviton 3 included some exciting, even further enhancements for AES, which included 8x parallel pipeline execution for AES, which unlocked up to 6,000 megabytes per second of throughput on a single CPU core. Now, maybe you're not doing tons and tons of bulk AES encryption, but this is still important for your use case because this further reduces the single latency of any one encryption call. So even if you're not doing a lot of encryption, this is a benefit of improving your responsiveness of your application. And what I find particularly exciting about this is if we look at the AWS-LC non-FIPS, the tip of our main branch performance, it is identical to the FIPS staging branch coming out later this year. So when we release the next FIPS release, you will be able to take advantage of this improved performance for free. Is all using the same API, so it's easy to update and migrate to the latest version, and easy to use in a variety of places. And this is another call out where to go back and look at your own application and see if there's any opportunities for batching of your data. As you can see on this graph, regardless of version you're using, as you increase your message size, maybe by batching smaller messages together, you can get improved performance because you amortize the setup and teardown calls in AWS-LC. This might not always be relevant. You should benchmark your code before and after, but this kind of approach of batching data to take advantage of more parallel execution is a potential savings for you and for us. Now, this is all great, and you're probably, I love graphs, I hope you love graphs as well, but this is a micro benchmark. This is looking at just AES-GCM on a single core in ideal circumstances. You might be interested in what is the real world impact of AWS-LC FIPS. So I'm excited to share this graph. This is showing the S3 TLS handshake latency in US Gov West 1. So this is just the latency to perform a TLS handshake measured server-side on S3. And you can see when we deployed AWS-LC FIPS, there's a nice drop in the graph where we decrease the handshake latency from around 9 milliseconds to about 6. So this is real-world savings that can improve that initial connection time when you connect to S3 or other AWS endpoints. And it's also important to note that this TLS handshake time is only noticed when you're first connecting. You can reuse these TLS connections for multiple API requests, but this is still real-world time that your application and your users can feel when they're first connecting. And finally, I have some additional links to all of the resources I talked about today. Again, if you're working on any Rust or Java libraries and applications, I encourage you to take a look at AWS-LC-RS and the Amazon Credo Crypto Provider as two easy-to-use drop-in replacements for your existing cryptography. And if you want to go deeper, I included links to AWS-LC, S2N TLS, and S2N Quick. Thank you. I'll be around to answer any questions, or you can reach out over my contact info. And please complete the session survey. I really appreciate the feedback, and I know the event staff really appreciates the data. Thank you.